Hello. So we have a case today of chondroblastoma. 10-year-old male child presented with a complaint of pain and swelling over the left shoulder for last 3 years. There is also history of pain radiation to the adjacent elbow for last 6 months. There is no history of trauma, fever, diabetes, and TB. History of trauma is important in any bone lesion, and also fever is also very important because it is used to rule out osteomyelitis. Personal history and family history were insignificant. Local examination, that is on inspection, a swelling was present over the left shoulder. Skin over the swelling was intact. No scar or abrasion or any discharge sinus was present. On palpation, local temperature was mildly raised. Tenderness present over the swelling. Swelling was firm in consistency. Distal neurovascular status was intact, but movements were painfully restricted. So the patient was advised X-ray, left shoulder, and a chest X-ray along with some blood investigations. So this is the X-ray of the same patient of left shoulder AP view showing a lesion in the proximal part of the humerus. So this is a closer look of the same lesion. Here is a lesion which appears lytic in nature. So we have a lesion that is very well defined lytic expansile lesion involving the epiphysis and also extending into the metaphysis. This is the epiphysis and also extending into the metaphysis. The margins of the lesion, that is most of the margins of the lesion, are very well defined. And they also appears mildly sclerotic. The matrix of the lesion has punctate type of, that is chondrite type of, punctate type of calcification is seen in the chondrite lesions. The matrix of the lesion has punctate type of calcification. This is the punctate type of calcification. Also we can see there is destruction of the superolateral part of the head of the humerus with adjacent cortical breach. This is the cortical breach. Other things like the acromion process, the coracoid process, the glenoid cavity appears normal. However, there is mild increase in the glenohumeral distance. This distance appears increased, which may be due to the fusion of the joint. So here we are dealing with a lesion that has very well defined margins. The margins are sclerotic and lesion expansile and lytic. So this kind of lesion is usually non-aggressive kind of lesion, but it also has some features of aggressiveness like cortical breach and destruction of upper part. These two features indicating that the lesion is aggressive, but most of the features of the lesion, that is sclerotic margins and very well defined margins, lytic lesion, suggesting that it is a benign or non-aggressive lesion. Chest X-ray of the patient was also done because it is used to rule out the secondaries, and we can also see the lesion of the humerus in this one also. Blood investigations on CBC, that is hemoglobin was 12 gram percent, WBC count and platelet count were normal. WBC count was normal, indicating there was no infection. Other blood investigations were insignificant. So on the basis of the radiographic picture only, we have the following differential diagnosis. First is chondroblastoma. Low grade osteosarcomas can also present like this. Chondromyxoid fibroma, clear cell chondrosarcoma. We can see most of the diagnosis differential DD contains chondroid lesions, that is chondroblastoma, chondromyxoid fibroma, chondrosarcoma, because our lesion has chondrite type of calcification, that is punctate type of calcification. Others also include osteomyelitis, example Brody's abscess. This Brody's abscess can also present as a lytic bone lesion. Aneurysmal bone cyst, eosinophilic granuloma, and GCT, this is giant cell tumor. We know that GCT, giant cell tumor, presents after the skeletal maturity, and our case is a 10-year-old male child, so it can easily be ruled out. Also, the eosinophilic granuloma is not very common in the long bones. It is more common in the skull and mandible, and it is less common in the long bones. And even when it presents in the long bone, it is more commonly diaphyseal, not epiphyseo-metaphyseal like our lesion. Also, the matrix of the eosinophilic granuloma is not calcified. So these two, eosinophilic granuloma and GCT, can easily be ruled out. So we are left with these as our differential diagnosis. Chondroblastoma. So chondroblastoma, also known as Codman's tumor, is a rare primary benign cartilaginous tumor arising from the chondroblast cells. Despite being rare, they are one of the most frequently encountered benign epiphyseal tumors in the skeletally immature patient. And we also have a skeletally immature patient. Usually involves the epiphyses of the long tubular bones with occasional extension into the metaphyses. The characteristic lesion of the chondroblastoma is epiphyseal, but it can extend, occasionally it can extend to the metaphyses, like our case. The age group of chondroblastoma is that it occurs usually before the obliteration of the growth plates, that is before 20 years of age, and it is more common in males. Our child is also a male child. Common sites includes proximal humerus, proximal tibia, proximal and distal femur. So coming on to the radiographical features, that is on a plain x-ray, the lesion of chondroblastoma, now we are talking about the chondroblastoma, the lesion of chondroblastoma usually appears as a oval or round, well-defined geographic kind of lytic lesion in the epiphyses of the long tubular bones with occasional extension into the metaphyses. Most of the lesions are eccentrically placed. There is a narrow zone of transition with sclerotic margins, indicating these two things indicate the lesion. Any lesion that has narrow zone of transition and sclerotic margins is usually a non-aggressive or benign kind of lesion. And chondroblastoma also has narrow zone of transition and sclerotic margins. Punctate type or fluffy cotton wool type of calcification, that is chondroid type of calcification, is seen in chondroblastoma. 2/3 of the lesions may show solid periosteal new bone formation. So here is an example of typical chondroblastoma. This is an x-ray of the proximal humeral showing a very well-defined lytic lesion in the epiphyses of the humerus. The margins of the lesions are quite well defined and also sclerotic. So this is a characteristic presentation of chondroblastoma. As I've told, the chondroblastoma characteristically presents in the epiphyses only and do not extend into the metaphyses usually, but it can have occasional extension. So, but the typical lesion is presents in the epiphyses only. Another example of chondroblastoma, we can see there is a lytic expansile lesion involving the not only the epiphyses of the tibia but also extending into the metaphyses. So this is also an example of chondroblastoma. This is another example of chondroblastoma in which we can see there is a lytic lesion involving the epiphyses. This is the epiphyseal part of the lesion, and also extending into the metaphyses. This is the metaphyseal part of the lesion, also extending to the metaphyses with fluffy cotton wool kind of calcification in the matrix. So the important point here I want to make is that the chondroblastoma characteristically presents in the epiphyses as a lytic lesion, but it can be extending into the metaphyses also, like this and also like this. That is, it can cross the growth plate. On histopathological examination, there is multinucleate giant cells in the chondroid matrix and chicken wire calcification is pathognomic. This is a giant cell in the chondroid matrix. This is chondroid matrix. MRI is ideal for the evaluation of the transphyseal extension and for demonstrating associated surrounding bone marrow edema, which is seen in most of the cases of the chondroblastoma. On MRI, low signal intensity on T1, it gives low signal intensity on T1 and high or intermediate intensity on T2. So, points in the favor of chondroblastoma. So, this is our lesion and we have to compare this lesion with chondroblastoma. So, first of all, our case is a 10-year-old male child and chondroblastoma is also common in this age group, that is before 20 years of age. First point in favor. Another point in favor is that sex, the chondroblastoma is more common in males and also our child is a male child. Another favorable point is that the chondroblastoma lesion of the chondroblastoma is usually present in the epiphysis, but it can extend into the metaphysis, that is it can be epiphyseo-metaphyseal lesion, and we also have a epiphyseo-metaphyseal lesion. Chondroblastoma presents as a lytic lesion with sclerotic margins and narrow zone of transition. All these three points can also be seen in our case, that is there's a lytic lesion with sclerotic margins and narrow zone of transition. There is a very narrow zone of transition. Matrix calcification is also seen in chondroblastoma, which can also be seen in our case. This is the matrix calcification, this is the matrix, and we have punctate type of, that is chondrite type of calcification in our case. There is a benign type of periosteal reaction seen in the chondroblastoma, which can also be seen in our case. This is a very minimal periosteal reaction is also visible here. The only point that goes against the chondroblastoma is that there is cortical breach in our case. There is minimal cortical breach in our case, which is usually not present in chondroblastoma because chondroblastoma is a benign lesion. So based on the radiographic and biochemical findings, most probable diagnosis is chondroblastoma. For further evaluation, MRI and histopathological examination of our patient was done, and also there is hyperintensity in T2 of the upper part of the diaphysis. This indicates the bone marrow edema. Histopathology report of our patient says giant cell containing chondroid lesion favoring chondroblastoma. That is, we have a lesion. This is the actual slide, histopathological slide of our patient, which shows chondroid matrix in which few giant cells can be seen. This is a giant cell, this is a giant cell, this is a giant cell, and this picture is a magnified view of the same, this giant cell. So we have the slide also shows that there is a chondroid matrix in which giant cells are present, further confirming our diagnosis. Thank you.